Hare Krishna. So wish you all a very happy Janmashtami today. And today, on the sacred appearance day of Lord Krishna, I'll talk on the topic of how Krishna demonstrates the way to happiness. So I'll talk about this in three parts. First, I'll talk about the broad search for happiness. Then I'll talk about one particular beautiful leela of Krishna, which demonstrates how Krishna infuses his devotee with satisfaction. And then we'll conclude by discussing how we can also find similar satisfaction. There are many different kinds of knowledge in the world. In fact, now with the expansion of the internet, you can get almost oceanic knowledge about anything and everything. When we want to study anything, when you want to know anything, actually there is science which is the study of matter. Study, okay, how does this object move? What laws, what principles? There is science gives us the study of matter, and scripture gives us the study of what matters. The study of matter and the study of what matters. Study of what matters means what is really important in life. What is it that will make our life meaningful? What is it that will enable our life to become joyful? If you come to this room, now if you were in the construction business, you might be interested very carefully, okay, what is the quality of this wood, what is the quality of these walls, what kind of paint is there. If you are a home designer, then you may want to look at the aesthetics. But if you come here for a satsang, your main concern will be, is there a good seat for me? You are not so much interested in the whole room. We are in the world is very complicated. We focus on what matters for us. So if you have come here for kirtan or class, then what matters for you is that you should be able to sit in a place where you can be reasonably comfortable and you can be reasonably attentive. So we, for us, the most important thing is what matters. And we are all Hare Krishna. In our lives, we are all looking for meaning and happiness. So Krishna, when he descends in this world, the famous verse in the Bhagavad-Gītā, Krishna says, paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duṣkṛtām dharma samsthāpanārthāya sambhavāmi yuge yuge sambhavāmi yuge. Krishna says, I come again and again. For what? Establishing dharma. Now what is dharma? Dharma is not just some archaic religious codes. It is not some prohibitive morality. It is not even some cultural norms. Dharma essentially means, if you look at the Sanskrit, dharma comes from the root dhri. Dhri is to sustain. So dharma refers to those activities that sustain our existence. Dharma refers to that action which keeps us in harmony with ourselves and in harmony with the world. So that is the way to happiness, to live in harmony with ourselves and with the world. To the extent we are in disharmony, we will not be happy. See, if everybody, if we are on the side of a road where everybody is going in this direction, and if we are going in the other direction, we will not be able to drive. Everybody will be honking at us. Everybody will be annoyed with us. So we need to be in harmony to be happy. So harmony can be at various levels. The most important thing is we understand our nature and live accordingly. So curiously, we will see in life, it is the search for happiness that is often the cause of the greatest unhappiness. The search for happiness is often the cause of the greatest unhappiness. That means that, say, people who become addicts, somebody becomes an alcoholic, somebody becomes a drug addict. Nowadays, people become internet addicts. So, they start out wanting some pleasure. But the very things that we do for pleasure, they end up causing us trouble. So, Krishna descends to this world. In the world where we live, there are many paths that promise pleasure. But most of them end up in trouble. So Krishna comes to teach us the path to real happiness. And that essentially is dharma. Dharma is that which is yata dharma amritam itam. Dharma is that which will give us amrita, which will give us the nectar that will take us towards immortality. And the path of lasting happiness is dharma. So with this brief background, let's look at a story. And this whole story is very, we could say, contrary to normal people's conceptions of what is happiness. So this is the story of an old friend of Krishna who was living in great poverty. Who is that? Sudama, yes. Now Sudama was a Brahmana, and he had gone with Krishna to the same Gurukul in his childhood. And often the friendships that are forged in childhood, they are very deep. And sometimes, of course, those friendships are forgotten. So Sudama had not forgotten. Oh, Krishna is my friend. And he knew that Krishna is now de facto the king of Dwarka. He was not officially the king, Ugrasen was the king, but Krishna was the most powerful person. And Sudama, although he was living in poverty, he was very devoted to Krishna. So in his remembrance of Krishna, in the remembrance of the sweet dealings he had with Krishna, he was satisfied. But his wife was very concerned that we don't have enough to take care of our home. They had a son. We don't have enough to take care of your son. So, the Brahmanas, their contribution to society is to give knowledge. So they give knowledge, and in response, people give them charity. So they don't take a salary, because then you become forced to flatter and pamper those who give the salary to them. So he was living on charity. So his wife said, "You please go and meet Krishna, and surely, even with out you telling your situation, Krishna will give us something to help." Now he did not want to use his relationship with Krishna for such a purpose. And he said that, "No, I don't want to go." Many people, they like to show the pride of proximity. And when they say, "Oh, I know this famous person, I know that famous person." Now, you may know that person, but does that person know you? That is the thing. But still, the pride of proximity is there. We want to make our place in the world by connecting with somebody who already has a big place in the world. That's just natural human psychology. But Sudama didn't want to use his friendship with Krishna for this purpose. But finally, when his wife was saying, "No, please go and meet Krishna." So then, he decided he will go. And he thought, at least this gives me an excuse to go and see Krishna. And then, as he was going toward Krishna, he thought that normally, whenever we go to meet someone, we give them some gift. He says, "What do I give?" So he told his wife, "Give me something." So she said, "We have nothing in our house." So she had just some broken rice, flat rice, poha. And she just packed it in a small bag and she gave it. And then he went there, and when he came to the big palace, he had lived just in a small village. And then to see the grandeur of the palace itself was amazing. And he was amazed. It was not that he was just impressed by the palace. He was impressed that his friend Krishna lives in something so wonderful. And then Initially, I had difficulty with the guards, to getting through all the guards and finally coming to the palace. And then he came there, and at that time, Krishna was delighted to see Sudama. He was a little nervous. Sometimes, if there are two friends, but one of them has made it big in life, and the other is not, then sometimes people who have made it big, they feel embarrassed to admit their antecedents. And, oh, that's a small person. I don't know you. Could very well have denied. He's a little nervous. Will Krishna recognize me? But as soon as Krishna saw him, Krishna was so delighted. Although Krishna here was a king, and Krishna ultimately is God, Krishna does not delight in his godhood. He delights in the reciprocation of love. And ultimately, the Bhagavad Gita reveals, the Bhagavad Gita and the Bhakti tradition reveals that God is a person who, just like us, loves love. Well, he has all the opulence in the world. Generally, whenever people need anything, they go to God and they pray. And Krishna or Vishnu, his consort is Lakshmi. And Lakshmi is the source of the fortune of everything for everyone. And she is the servant of Krishna. Therefore, Krishna, Vishnu, they have everything they want. And yet, there is one thing that Krishna doesn't have. And that one thing that Krishna doesn't have is something which each one of us has. And each one of us can offer to him. And that is love. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, when he talks about different people who approach him, he says, Chaturvidha bhajante mam jana sukritino arjuna arto jigyasura arthati jnani cha bharata arshabha. Says different people come to him for various purposes. Some people say, oh God, I'm in trouble, please help me. Some people say, I don't have enough money, please give me something. Some people say, what is this God business? I want to know a little bit about it. Some people understand that God is the ultimate reality and come to connect with Him. Like that, different people come for different purposes. But Krishna says in the next verse, this is 5.7.16 and 7.17 in the Bhagavad Gita, He says, Udara sarva evaite jnanitvatmaiva me matam asthita sahayuktatma mamevanuttamam gatim. So he says, all these people, whatever be the reason they come to me, if they worship me, if they try to devote themselves to me, then they are udaraha. Now what does the word udara mean? Does anyone know? What does the word udara mean? Udara is giving, charitable. So now Krishna is saying, these people who come to him, they are charitable, they're udara. So what does it mean, udara? So Ramanujacharya is one of the great bhakti saints, and he describes that Krishna is so hungry for the love of his devotees, for the love of everyone, that if somebody comes and offers a little devotion, even if it is for utilitarian purposes, will come and offer some prayer, some devotion, so that God will give something to them. But at least for that purpose, they're offering some devotion. And if they do that, Krishna feels so grateful. Oh, you are so charitable. Krishna can own everything in the world, but there is one thing which he can't own, and that is our hearts, our heart. It is we who have to offer our heart to him. And if anybody offers even a little fraction of their heart to Krishna, Krishna feels so enriched by that. Krishna feels grateful. And he says, you are so charitable. So, when Krishna saw Sudama, at that time, he was so happy to see someone who loved him so much. And Krishna got off his chariot and ran to Sudama. And when Sudama saw how regally Krishna was dressed, he felt, oh, I am so simple, I am so dirty, I've come from a long journey. And he tried to shrink away from Krishna. But Krishna just jumped, charged forward and hugged Sudama. He said, oh, my dear friend, after so long we are meeting. And then Krishna took Sudama and sat him on the same seat, on the same throne, which he would sit. And then Krishna performed the arati of Sudama. Krishna washed the feet of Sudama. Krishna offered him immense honor. And then Krishna asked, now Sudama was thinking, as he was looking at this big palace, what can I offer Krishna? I have brought this flat rice. This is not worth giving to Krishna. And Krishna could see in the heart of Sudama. And his one side, because his heart was filled with love, he wanted to offer something to Krishna. But on the other hand, he felt what I am offering is not worthy to be offered to Krishna. Yes. And this is what makes love the sweetest. See, when love is accompanied by humility, then that makes the love extremely sweet. If somebody offers us some attention or affection, but they make it seem as if they are doing a big favor to us, then yes, we might accept it, but that doesn't really please the heart so much. Somebody is kind, but they are also condescending. They are helpful, but they look down upon us. But that doesn't work so much. Yes, that's why when people talk about romantic love, the phrase that is used is, you fall in love. It's not that you stand in love. It's what happens, we are captivated by the object of love. So there is this, similarly, this, there was the longing to offer something to Krishna, but at the same time, they're feeling that what I offer is not worthy of Krishna. And this devotion combined with humility, it's extremely endearing to Krishna. So Krishna himself said, Sudama, what have you brought for me? And then Krishna, Sudama was keeping that small pack of rice hidden. And Krishna said, no, give it to me. And he took it and he opened it, and with great joy he started eating it. He took one morsel and he said, this is so delicious. I've never eaten food as delicious as this. No, actually that was simply just some chipped rice. Krishna was not tasting that rice. Krishna was tasting the devotion of Sudama. And Krishna wanted to eat one more morsel. And now Rukmini Devi, she loved Krishna and she felt that she wanted to offer the best of cooked food to Krishna. And she said, Krishna, she felt this is so simple. She said, Krishna, oh my Lord, just by eating one morsel, you have satisfied the whole universe. Now she also understood, if we love someone, we also need to love those whom that person loves. So she did not think, oh, Sudama is just a poor person and he has brought some poor food. She didn't say, this food is not worthy of you. What she said is, just by eating this little food, one morsel, you satisfied the whole universe. She respected Sudama and she respected Krishna's affection for Sudama. And then she took that food. She said, let me also have some. And then Krishna and Sudama sat and they talked. When old friends meet after a long time, there's so much to catch up. Life keeps moving forward and then we want to catch up. So then they talk. And Sudama spent a blissful time with Krishna. And he was so blissful being with Krishna, being in Krishna's presence, that he forgot all about his request. Now he was in great poverty and he had come at one level to get some relief from the poverty. But when he became absorbed in Krishna, when Krishna's presence, that absorption was so enriching that he just forgot to ask Krishna for anything. And then after staying for some time with Krishna, spending a blissful time with him, he then told Krishna, I'll make a moon. Please give me your permission to leave. And Krishna reluctantly agreed. And then as Sudama was leaving, At that time, he started thinking that is a beautiful verse which describes his thought. He says, Kwaham Taritra Papiya Kwa Krishna Shri Niketana Brahma Bandhu Idismaham Bahu Bhyam Parirambitaha. He says, look at the contrast. He says, Kwaham Taridra Papiya. He says, I am a poverty stricken person. And it is his humility that makes him say, but why am I poor? It is because of my own past karma. I am papi, I am a wrongdoer. That is why I am in distress. For all of us, the way we look at the world determines how we will work in the world. All of us can list many, many things that are wrong in our life. And when things are wrong in our life, broadly, there could be two possibilities. That something is wrong with the world or something is wrong with us. Now, it might pamper our ego to say that actually the world is a terrible place. This person is unfair. This is unfair. That is unfair. Yes, but you know, if something is wrong with the world, then that might help us shift the blame to the world, but that also takes away our power. Because if something is wrong with the world, good luck trying to fix the world. It's impossible. But if something is wrong, something were wrong with us, then although it's discouraging, it may not be very good for our ego. Oh, something is wrong with me. But at least there is some hope of fixing it. So whenever something is wrong in our life, rather than thinking, oh, the world is so unfair, people are so unfair, that's why things are wrong in my life, we take the responsibility. Maybe there's something that I'm doing wrong. Maybe there's something I can fix. Then that is the path to be able to do something positive in our life. So here we see Sudama exhibiting this. He's poor. But he is not resentful because he is poor. Kwaham daridra papiya. Maybe because I did something wrong in my past, that's why I am so poor right now. So actually, the more we take responsibility for our situation, the more we can change our situation. The more we blame for our situation, the more we lose the power to change that situation. And Sudama, we see, he's not blaming anyone. And then what is he saying? Kwaham daridra papiyan kwa Krishna Shri Niketana. So he says, I am a poor, sinful person, and Krishna is the Lord of the Goddess of Fortune. He is Shri Niketana. And as Shri Niketana, he says, yes, but Krishna loves Brahmanas. But he says, actually, I am not even a Brahmana. Kaham Brahma Bandhu Swaham. He says, I am a Brahma Bandhu, just a friend of a Brahmana, relative of a Brahmana. I don't have any Brahmanical qualities. And still, Bahubhyam Parirambhataha. Says, Krishna embraced me personally. How special is Krishna that he embraced me like this? So, here he appreciates what he has got, not what he didn't get. He didn't think, oh, I went to Krishna and Krishna was so wealthy and he didn't give me anything. He said, although I was so unworthy, Krishna gave me his own embrace. And he is filled with ecstasy, thinking of how much Krishna has been loving towards him, so affectionate towards him. And this is actually the miracle of devotion. For many people, when they tell the Sudama story, they tell eventually that when Sudama went back home and he found that his small hut had been transformed into a big palace. And his children, his wife, they were all dressed in wonderful clothes. And this is how Krishna reciprocated Sudama. Even without asking, Krishna gave Sudama abundantly. And that is seen as miraculous. Well, yes, that is a miracle. But the bigger miracle, the miracle that Krishna performed was not that Sudama's small hut was transformed into a palace. Yes, that's a miracle. But the bigger miracle was that even when Sudama had nothing, Sudama was not complaining. He was not resenting. Sudama was satisfied. Not but satisfied, he was ecstatic. Why? Because he was appreciating the love that Krishna had showed on him. So satisfaction comes not by acquiring what we want. Satisfaction comes by appreciating what we have. In every situation, there is something that we have and something that we want. Now what we want, that list can expand unlimitedly. So if we think, I'll get satisfied when I get what I want, then that is the path to perpetual dissatisfaction. Because no matter how much we get, we'll keep wanting more and more and more. Sometimes if you have a small child, then you buy some new clothes for that child. And then for a short while you wear those clothes, the child wears the clothes, and the child grows. And then his clothes no longer fit. And then you have to get bigger clothes. And the child grows bigger. So, now when their children are small, they grow very fast. So, similarly, want. Want is like a child who outgrows everything we provide. By the time we provide something that we think we wanted, we get it, and then it is grown. Want has grown further. And we provide the next thing and want has grown further. So if we base our satisfaction on acquiring what we want, we'll be always dissatisfied. We'll be never satisfied. But Sudama demonstrates, how did he become happy? Not by acquiring what he wanted, but by appreciating what he had. So what did he have? He thought that when I went to where Krishna and met Krishna, Krishna remembered me, Krishna remembered our friendship. Krishna offered me so much love and respect and affection. And he was delighted with that. So for all of us, Krishna is present in our hearts. Now Krishna, bahubhyam parirambhita. Krishna embraces us within our own hearts. Sarvasya chaham hridisan nivishto. Krishna resides in our hearts with each one of us. And if we turn toward Krishna and connect with Him, Krishna is all attractive. Sarva akarshati iti Krishna. Krishna is full of all joy. Sarva sukha sagar, sarva gunagar, sabha sukha sagar, sabha gunagar. So Krishna is the ocean of happiness. If we turn toward Krishna by the practice of bhakti, then we can experience satisfaction in whatever situation we are in. We can experience not just satisfaction but enrichment. So Krishna comes to this world not just to set things right in the world. Krishna comes to the world primarily to set things right in our heart. In our heart, we all have decided what we value the most. And often, what we treasure the greatest is not our greatest treasure. We often treasure, I want this. If only I get this, I'll become happy. If only I get that, I'll become happy. Actually, to be happy is possible. But we don't want to be happy. What do you mean? I want to be happy. Everyone wants to be happy. No, we don't want to be happy. We want to be happier than others. To be happy is possible. To be happier than others is impossible. Why? Because we usually overestimate how happy people are. Everybody is having their challenges. But we think, especially, you might see somebody going in a big posh Mercedes or Porsche or something, And we might look at them and we say, oh, this person is so successful, so happy. And who knows, that person who is driving that car might be so frustrated that at the next cliff they drive over the car and end their life. The images that make us burn with envy and resentment are often illusions produced by our own mind. So satisfaction doesn't come by acquiring what we want. It comes by appreciating what we have. And each one of us has Krishna in our hearts. And Krishna has given us enough. If we learn to appreciate what we have, we can be happy in the situation that we are in. And if we appreciate what we have, Krishna can give us much, much more. So Krishna gave Sudama abundantly. But it was not what Krishna gave Sudama externally that made Sudama happy. It was what Krishna gave Sudama internally. What was it that Krishna gave Sudama internally? That was the devotion. The attitude of appreciating what was there with him. Appreciating the love that Krishna had given him. And when he saw that, he became happy. So for each one of us, Krishna comes to demonstrate, not just through his teachings in the Bhagavad Gita. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that if you want to be happy, the way to happiness is what? By cultivating satisfaction. Mana prasada saumyatvam. Satisfaction comes by looking at what we have, not looking at what we don't have. And Sudama helps demonstrate. So Krishna doesn't just teach actions. Krishna demonstrates through his devotees the way to happiness. So through Sudama, Krishna is teaching us, if we learn to appreciate what we have, all of us can be happier than what we are. And ultimately, if we appreciate Krishna and what Krishna is doing in our lives for us, then Krishna can do so much more for us. Krishna, I'll conclude with this point, and then we can have a few questions if you like. Krishna is Krishna's greatest gift. Krishna is Krishna's greatest gift. That means we may all come to God, oh, please give me this, please give me that. And that's fine, it's natural that we may ask. But the greatest thing that Krishna can give us is not just fulfill our this desire or that desire or that desire. Because whatever he fulfills, it's all temporary. It'll give us some pleasure for some time. After that, it'll be finished. But if Krishna reveals himself in his heart, if Krishna reveals his attractiveness to us, if we become attracted to him, then in that devotion, there is the supreme satisfaction. So when Krishna, he descended on Janmashtami day thousands of years ago. And similarly, this is not just a historical event. This is meant to be an eternal event. Just as Krishna descended to this world thousands of years ago, Krishna can descend and manifest in our hearts. And when he manifests in our heart, actually he can fill us with the supreme satisfaction. Krishna appeared in a prison cell in Mathura. And that represents that actually we all are attached to various things. Attachment is like emotional enslavement. Attachment is emotional imprisonment. When we are attached to something, all our emotions get locked in that thing. And if that one thing is not working out, then we are miserable. Even if 100 other things are working out, if that one thing is not working out, we just can't be happy. If somebody is, say, attached to cricket, they might be living happily, they might have their family, they might have good health, they might have a good job. But if their favorite team loses, they will feel utterly miserable. What? Attachment is emotional enslavement. If you are attached to something, our emotions get locked in that thing. And 100 other things may be good in our lives, we can't see that. We just see that one thing which is bad, one thing which is not working, and we'll be unhappy. So Krishna came in a prison. And as soon as Krishna came there, what happened? The prison doors opened. Vasudev and Devaki, his parents, they were shackled, but the shackles broke away. And they took Krishna out of that prison. So similarly, when Krishna appears in our hearts, whatever emotional enslavement that is there, we become free from that. That doesn't mean that we become uncaring or irresponsible. Detachment is not absence of emotion. Detachment is absence of emotional dependence. When we are attached, we are emotionally dependent on things. We all need many things in life. But if something is not working out, we need to move on. Okay, this is not working out. I won't make my whole existence dependent on it. I won't let my happiness depend on this alone. I won't let myself get distracted by this. So I won't let one thing reduce my life to unhappiness. If we connect with Krishna, then what will happen is, distresses will come in everyone's life. That is unavoidable. But if we are connected with Krishna, then that connection with Krishna will give us strength and satisfaction. We may have to live with pain, but we won't have to live in pain. Pain might be a part of our life, but if we are attached to something, then that thing, pain, will consume our whole life. If something is wrong, we can't deny it. Yes, that's wrong, but we don't have to obsess over it. If we are connected with Krishna, we'll see things that in perspective. Okay, this is wrong. Let me do what I can to fix it. But let me move on with my life. Let me not obsess over it. So the path to satisfaction is not acquiring what we have, craving, I don't have this, slaving, when will I get it? No, the path to satisfaction is appreciating what we have. And what among all the things that we have, the most important thing ultimately is Krishna. He's there in our hearts. And if we can get the devotion by which we can appreciate Krishna's presence in our heart, then we can always be enriched. Whatever situation we are in, we can be internally satisfied. And once we are internally satisfied, then we have a stable foundation for our life. Our consciousness and the state of our consciousness is our most important asset. If our consciousness is satisfied, if our consciousness is peaceful, then we can work the best of our capacity to get other things, to fix other things, to manage other things. If our consciousness is agitated and then we are working very hard, I'll get this, I'll get that, I'll get that. Now that craving for comforts at the cost of our consciousness is like buying an expensive painting at the cost of our eyes. Getting an expensive painting is wonderful, but if we have to pay with our eyes, what are we going to appreciate? So if chasing after things of the world makes our consciousness agitated, takes our consciousness away from Krishna, then even if we get those things, they will never make us happy. Krishna says in the Bhagavad-Gītā, Nasti buddhira yuktasya na cha yuktasya bhavana na cha bhavyata shanti ashantasya kutaha sukham. He says, if our consciousness is not spiritualized, our mind can't be peaceful. And if our mind is not peaceful, how can there be happiness? So the path to satisfaction is inside out. Appreciate Krishna who is in our hearts. Appreciate what Krishna has given us. And then with that foundation of appreciation, when we work, whether we acquire things or we don't acquire things, we will still be satisfied. So the path to inner satisfaction is what Krishna comes to demonstrate. So on this Janmashtami day, we can pray to Krishna that He manifest in our hearts. He give us the devotion by which we can appreciate His presence in our hearts, and thereby we can become enriched eternally. So I'll summarize and then we can have a few questions. So I spoke on the theme of how Krishna descends to reveal the path of happiness. All of us are looking for happiness in various things, but often the search for happiness becomes the cause of the greatest unhappiness. The very things we crave and slave for, if we get them, we end up frustrated. If we don't get them, again we end up frustrated. So, and what is the way to satisfaction? I took out the story of Sudama. He was poor, and normally we'll think poor people will be unhappy. But he was happy because he was absorbed in Krishna. Now he had contact with Krishna, but he didn't want to use that relationship to get wealth. So when he went to Krishna, he went not to ask for wealth, but just to see Krishna. And Krishna is a God who is hungry for love. Although Krishna is the Lord of the Goddess of Fortune, he has everything. But we have one thing which Krishna doesn't have, and which Krishna wants. And that is the love of our hearts. But Krishna says, those who offer him devotion are charitable, udara. So because Sudama gave that love of his heart freely to Krishna, Krishna felt so delighted, so happy. Krishna honored him, Krishna worshipped him, and then Krishna enriched him. Krishna transformed his small palace into a small hut into a big, magnificent palace. But that was not Krishna's greatest gift. Krishna's greatest gift was that even without getting anything, Sudama felt enriched. I said, Sudama, he was poor, but he was thinking, this poverty is because of my own misdeeds. See, when things are wrong in our life, either it can be because the world is wrong or we are wrong. Like the world is wrong, it is easy to blame the world, but how can you fix it? It disempowers us. So blaming disempowers us. Taking responsibility empowers us. So he's thinking, it's by my own misdeeds, I'm unhappy. So let me fix the things. So he was grateful and satisfied, ecstatic that Krishna had embraced him. So the key lesson from this talk was that satisfaction comes not by acquiring what we don't have, by acquiring what we want, but by appreciating what we have. Want is like a giant who outgrows every cloth that we provide him. So if we want to be happy and we determine our wants by what other people have and I don't have, we will never become happy. To be happy is possible, to be happier than others is impossible. So what can we appreciate? Actually, Krishna is the source of all happiness and he is present in our hearts. So if we can appreciate his presence by practicing bhakti, then whatever situation we are in, we can be satisfied. And that satisfaction can be like the foundation on which we build the subsequent structures of our life. If we let our consciousness go away from Krishna and become agitated, then even if we achieve the best comforts and conveniences of the world, that will be like buying an expensive painting at the cost of our ears. We will not be happy. But on this Janmashtami day, if we pray to Krishna, that Krishna, please enrich my heart with your presence, with devotion for you, then whatever situation we are in, we might be in pain. We may have to live with pain, but we won't have to live in pain. In whatever situation we are in, Krishna can enrich us through devotion with satisfaction. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, please. Okay. So what happens first? Is it detachment from the world or Krishna descending in our hearts? There is no necessarily one or the other. The essential principle is that we begin with what we have. It's like the old question, chicken came first or the egg came first? Well, don't bother about that. Begin with what you have. So of course we don't eat meat. But if somebody is cooking, if somebody wants to prepare a meal, you begin with what you have. So, well, if we have detachment, begin with detachment. If we have some attraction toward Krishna, we begin with that attraction toward Krishna. The idea is that this is a process which needs to be begun wherever we can. So it might be that people have some conceptions of what will make them happy, and those things don't make them happy. And then they become a little detached and they start exploring what is more in life. So then by that exploration, Krishna manifests in their heart. So it could be detachment from their ideas of what will make them happy, leading to Krishna's presence in their heart. Or it could also be that maybe because of their culture, because of their previous life spiritual practice, there's already some awareness of Krishna's presence, some awareness of the value of spirituality. And because of that, they're not detached. So purvabhyasena tenaiva riyate yavashopi saha. The Bhagavad-Gita says that those who have practiced spiritual life previously, they're spontaneously detached from the world. Jigyasu shabda brahmati vartate. They already have attachment. So sometimes it could be that Krishna by his own arrangement manifests in our heart, and that manifestation of Krishna in our heart attracts us so much that we become detached from other things. Or sometimes it may be that because we are detached from the world, we start exploring Krishna more. So whichever way we begin, that's okay. Just begin, that's the important thing. And Krishna will provide us what we need. Any other questions? Yes.
Just to follow up on that, what about those people who have neither of those things?
Okay. What about people? Yeah. What about people who don't have either detachment or any attraction toward Krishna or Krishna's presence? Well, then they have to meet someone who has one of those things. So generally, our desires are not just linear, they are also triangular. See, linear desire means we see something and we desire it. Say for example, now we are fasting. So some of us might be fasting today on Janmashtami. Say, if we see some delicious food which we like, we see it and we just get the desire for it. So that's linear desire. We see an object and we get the desire. But not all desires are linear. Does anyone know what is a baklava? Does anyone know? Okay, baklava. Actually, of 5-6 years ago, first time when I had gone to Australia, I had never heard of a baklava. So I went to a devotee's house and he had prepared prasad. So for dessert, they said, would you like to have baklava? I had never heard of a baklava. And the name baklava is not very sweet. Baklava. Okay, so then I said, maybe later. And then there was another devotee who had come with me also. So he said, you give. And then he took the baklava and he was savoring it. He's closing his eyes and relishing it. And I looked at him and I said, give me one also. So what happened was, there was no linear desire, but there was a triangular desire. So just seeing the baklava or hearing about the baklava didn't create the desire. But seeing someone relishing the baklava created the desire. So in general, there are some objects in the world which are very attractive. And just seeing those objects creates the desire within us. But with respect to most virtues, the desires are very rarely created linearly. With respect to any virtue, the desire is created triangularly. Say, if somebody is very honest, somebody always keeps their promises, somebody is very principled. You know, just living a life of principles might seem like austerity. But if somebody doing that, this person always does that, I also want to be like this. So similarly, with respect to spirituality, it is very rare that somebody comes to a temple and sees Krishna and just falls in love with Krishna. They just completely become devoted to Krishna. It happens, but it's very rare. And even if somebody faces problems in life, somebody faces reversals. See, most people become frustrated, few people become detached. There's a big difference between the two. Frustration is, I want something but I'm not getting it. Detachment is, I don't want this because there's something better in life. So frustration is universal, detachment is very rare. So even if people get frustrated, okay, they're frustrated, but again they start pursuing, after some time the frustration goes down. So just either by looking at Krishna or by looking at the world's distresses, the spiritual desire may not come. But it is by associating with spiritually minded people. So if we come and associate with devotees, or come in satsang programs like this, and then we might have a certain conception of success in our lives. And then we see people who are already at that conception of success. We might think, oh, somebody is very wealthy, is very happy. But then we see somebody is very wealthy, they are coming and practicing bhakti. Say, okay, they have wealth, but why do they need to practice bhakti? Maybe there's bhakti, more in bhakti. So generally, if somebody has neither, then if somehow they get the association of devotees, then that's how their spiritual journey will begin. And that's why if we are practicing bhakti, it is our responsibility to try to act in such a way that through the triangularity of desires, others' spiritual desire gets activated. Okay. Thank you. Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki, Janmashtami Mahamahotsav ki, Shri Prabhupada ki, Jai Gaur Premanande.